بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن والاه أما بعد. This is our 18th lesson going through the kitab Umdat Ahkaam من كلام خير الأنام صلى الله عليه وسلم. We're still in كتاب الطهارة. This book was authored by عبد الغين عبد الواحد المقدسي رحمه الله تعالى. We have brought the باب الحيض, the chapter of الحيض. الحيض refers to سيلان, السيلان, that which flows. And the شريعة refers to سيلان الدم. It is the natural flow of, it's the flow of natural blood, دمٌ طبيعي, natural blood, regular blood, يعتاد الأنثى, that comes to the woman on a regular basis. And this is يعني, a major sign of her being being able to يعني, conceive or have children, become pregnant, and also that she reaches the age of puberty. It's the major sign of puberty. And this is natural يعني, blood that comes out of the woman يعني, in a periodic sense, in a periodic manner, يعني, each month. It's a certain cycle that يعني, she goes through, and this part of the period is when this blood comes out, this thick dark blood that has an odor. And al-hayd is very important to understand because there are certain rulings pertaining to it. For example, يحرم عليها أشياء. There are things that become haram for the woman when she enters into the state of al-hayd. Now, and that this is the original principle al-asl fi al-dam الذي يصيب الماء أو الذي يصيب المرأة أنه حيض. The original blood or the original stance that we have concerning any blood that comes out of the woman is that it is دم حيض. Then we have that which comes out of the woman that is not دم الحيض, and that is not دم الاستحاضة, irregular abnormal vaginal bleeding. When you have this blood, that, and how can you know دم الاستحاضة is blood that doesn't stop from the woman, or يعني for most of the month, this blood continues to fall from her, continues to come out from her. This is known as damul istihada, and this dam is irregular forms of bleeding, and there are rulings specific to that she doesn't have, or that don't apply when she's in the state of al-hayd. Now, and ikhwan, we can summarize the whole chapter of babul hayd and babul istihada in three ways. Number one, a woman who knows. So as we know, دم الاستحاضة, we said, it is blood that occurs throughout the month. And as we mentioned, دم الحيض comes at a specific time in the month. So for example, you have a woman who her period comes from the 1st to the 7th of every single month. From the 1st to the 7th of every single month. She knows this. This is her custom. She knows it. That's her time for the period. But then she has, يعني, throughout the month, 24, 25 days out of the month, she can't get rid of this. She still has this irregular bleeding, this abnormal vaginal bleeding known as al-istihada. What should she do? That's the first scenario. And if you're able to understand that scenario, that's the first third, that's one third of this chapter completed. The second third of the chapter is a woman who doesn't actually know or doesn't actually have a specific cycle that she's able to يعني, rely upon, unlike the first case. What does she do? The third case is the one who's unable to have a natural, she doesn't have a irregular cycle that she has, that she's put to memory, nor is she able to distinguish between the damul hayd and dam al-istihada. Then what should she do? So those are the three main cases that generally occur in women when it comes to dam al-hayd and dam al-istihada. When there's these two mix, these two bloods that come out together at the same time, dam al-istihada being for a far longer period throughout the month, the mudhayd of course being for a certain amount of the month. We say for the first case, المرأة التي تعرف مدة حيضتها, the woman who has a knowledge of her menstrual cycle, she knows it very well, then she sits and she applies herself as a woman in her period for those 7 days that she knows, or for those that period that she has knowledge of. And outside of that, what she does is she prays a salah, and she's no longer in the state of her period, and she washes off the blood from her, and she performs the ghusl. And then she prays a salah that she's supposed to pray until the next period cycle comes, and so on and so forth. As for the second case, the woman who doesn't have a set cycle, she doesn't know that she doesn't have a set cycle at the 1st to the 7th of every single month, she doesn't have that, then she has to distinguish between the blood that is damul hayd and dam al-istihada. Damul hayd is generally dark, thick, and has an odor, whereas the normal irregular bleeding is that the blood that comes out of other veins. As the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, إِنَّ ذَلِكَ عِرْقٌ, indeed that is a burst vein. فَإِلَى تَمِيزِهَا. Now, and then the third case is the one who can't the one who's unable to distinguish between damul hayd and istihadha, then she has to return back to the general consensus of the time period of a period cycle that the women have in a country or in her region. And generally, in nowadays, it's 6 to 7 days. Sitat ayyam, no, sab' ayyam. So this is the third case. So she sits for the first six days or the first 7 days of the month, and the remaining 23 days she prays. And she applies that for each scenario. As for the woman who's able to distinguish the blood, damul istihadha, damul hayd, then the period where damul hayd is prevalent or is present, she stays away from salah. And that also, which is and also all of the acts that are haram upon her, like al-siyam, like al-jima' ghayr dhalik. And then when that time period finishes, she then goes back to her prayer, and she does this each month, looking at herself, looking at her blood, trying to distinguish between whether it's blood hayd or blood istihadha. And if you're unable to do that, then you just return back to the ghalib, عَادَتْ النِّسَاءِ فِي بَلَدِكِ. Return back to the general consensus that your people have, which is generally 6 to 7 days, according to medical doctors around the world. And so you sit for the first 6 to 7 days of the month, and then the rest of the month you pray the salah. And so that is the brief summary of Bab al-Hayd. Now going into the hadith. The first hadith is what we've spoken about. دَمُ الْإِسْتِحَاضُ دَمُ الْحَيْضُ وَعَنَا عَيْشَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى عَنْهَا أن فاطمة بنت أبي حبيش سألت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فقالت إني أستحاض فلا أطهر أفأدع الصلاة؟ قال لا، إن ذلك عرق، ولكن دع الصلاة قدر الأيام التي كنت تحيضين فيها ثم اغتسلي وصلي. وفي رواية وليس بالحيضة، فإذا أقبلت الحيضة فاترك الصلاة، فإذا ذهب قدرها فاغسلي عنك الدم وصلي. And so here the main benefit we gain from this hadith is that the one who has this irregular state of bleeding, that she stays away from the prayer during her period cycle. We mentioned that the way in which you're able to determine the period cycle, whether you actually know it through your custom, through your knowledge, through how you know your body, you know that it's during this time, from this day to that day where I get my period. Or if you don't know that, then you're able to distinguish between the period blood and the non-period blood. And if you're not unable to do that, you just follow the general consensus amongst the women in your land, or amongst the medical doctors in your land, which will generally be 6 or 7 days. And so you spend that time period out of prayer. You don't pray during that period. And when that period ends, you wash yourself, you wash off the blood from your body, and you continue to pray, and you start to pray your salah up until the next period cycle comes. The next hadith, وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها أن أم حبيبة استحيضت 7 سنين فسألت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن ذلك فأمرها أن تغتسل فكانت تغتسل لكل صلاة. And so here we have the hadith of Aisha, that Ummi Habiba here is not the wife of the Prophet, rather it's Ummu Habiba binti Jahsh. Ummu Habiba binti Jahshin, and she's a sister of Umm al-Mu'mineen Zainab binti Jahshin, and the cousin of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She had this irregular bleeding for 7 years, and so while she had this irregular period, she asked the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam about it. And so the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam commanded her to wash herself when after her time period, her general period, the period cycle ends, she should wash herself. And so she would wash herself for every single salah. فَكَانَتْ تَغْتَسِلُ لِكُلِّ صَلَاةٍ أي لِكُلِّ صَلَاةٍ مَفْرُوضَةٍ. She would wash off the blood from her body for every single salah. Now, and as we can see here, that the irregular bleeding can stop. It can end. قَدْ تَنْقَطِعْ وَقَدْ تَنْتَهِي مُدَّتُهَا. Here, it took her 7 years, but after the 7 years, it stopped, and she was able to go back to her normal cycle. The next hadith, وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت كنت أغتسل أنا والنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم من إناء واحد كلانا جنب فكان يأمرني فأتزر فيباشرني وأنا حائض. So we know from this hadith, the first benefit we gain from this hadith is, can a man and his wife wash together from one utensil? Can a man and his wife wash together from one utensil? There is no harm in that. There is no harm in that. And as we know in the hadith of Maymunah, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to wash from the remnants of water from the remnants of the water in the utensil that Maymunah had used, and likewise she would do the same. And so there is no problem in a man washing with his wife from one utensil, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam did with his wife here, Aisha. Wa kilana junuba, both of us are in the state of al-janaba, due to the asl being in the mu'mina la yanjus. Now, then we have the next benefit we hear from this hadith. مباشرة الحائض, for playing with one's wife, which is in her menstrual cycle. As we know, لا يجوز الجماع. it is prohibited for a woman, a man, to have sexual intercourse with his wife when she's in the state of her menstrual cycle. It is impermissible for a man to do the act of jima', the sexual intercourse, the pen entering into the ink during the state of, during her state of menstrual, during her period, when she's in her period. However, foreplaying with one's wife is permissible. Foreplaying one's wife is permissible. بَلْ يُبَاشِرُهَا. It is allowed for a person to foreplay with his wife, kiss his wife, fondle his wife, etc. during this period. However, as we see here, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he do? He commanded her for التزير, to cover this period, to cover this region of her body, which is from the surah to the rukbah, to cover this region of the body. فَكَانَ يُبَاشِرُ. And then the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he would then foreplay with his wife radiyallahu anha while she was in the state of menstrual cycle. And this is of course a beneficial point here is that you find that the Jews at the time, they wouldn't touch their wives when their wives were in the state of the period, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said نساؤكم حرث لكم فأتوا حرثكم أن شئتم وقدموا لأنفسكم واتقوا الله وعلموا. In those verses, that back in the period of the Jahiliyyah, they would not touch their wives, they would view their wives as najis, as impure, and they wouldn't eat from the same sihaf as their wife, they wouldn't even give any care to their wives when their wives were in the state of impurity, when their wives were in the state of al-hayd, the menstrual period. As for the Prophet ﷺ here, we find that he was alian al-nas, the most soft of people with his wives, even when they were in the state of menstrual cycle, that he would still play with them, foreplay with them, drink from the same cup that she would drink from, eat with her, and so on and so forth. However, when he would foreplay with her, alayha radhiyallahu, he would command her to cover her region, and he would then foreplay with her. So the foreplaying does not take place between the surah and the rukbah, but anywhere else other than that. Na'am. So that's what we gain from this hadith. And so one should always be with his wife, even when she's in her state of the menstrual period. He should still be soft with her and still treat her as though she is his woman, his right hand. Na'am. The next hadith. وَكَانَ يُخْرِجُ رَأْسَهُ إِلَيَّ وَهُوَ مُعْتَكِفٌ فَأَغْسِلُهُ وَأَنَا حَائِضٌ. And here we find another benefit, that a man, the Messenger of Allah here, he would take out his head during the state of al-i'tikaf into her home, and she would be able to wash his head, and she was still in the state of janaba during that time, or still in the state of al-hayd during that time. And so the permissibility of a person to, he can put out his head whilst in the state of i'tikaf. So i'tikaf, as we know, is that a person stays in the masjid, and this generally occurs during the last 10 days of the Ramadan, right? And so here, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would stay in the masjid, where he would then extend his head out of the masjid, in order for his wife to wash it, and in order for him, husnul mu'ashara, in order for him to show his face to her, so she could see his blessed face. عليها رضوان الله وعليه صلاة الله وسلامه. The next hadith. وعن عائشة رضي الله تعالى عنها قالت كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يتكئ في حجري وأنا حائض فأقرأ القرآن. Here we find again that the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم حسن معاشرته مع زوجاته, the way in which he would live well with his wives even when they were in the state of الحيض, even when they were in the menstrual period, he would still lie on the lap of his wife, be with his wife, be close with his wife, have a relationship with his wife, as opposed to, as I said, the Jews and the Mushrikeen, who would completely desert their wives when their wives would be in the state of al-hayd. But the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is teaching us here that one shouldn't desert his wife when they are in the state of al-hayd. Rather, he should be with them, close with them, sit with them, read Quran whilst they are there, and show his face to them, and give them that state of happiness and serenity that they have. Because as we know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed between husband and wife al-mawaddah wal-rahma, mercy and love between, and compassion between the two husband or the two spouses, the husband and the wife. And so, it is not befitting for a person to desert or leave off his wife when she's in the state of al-hayd. And this is a cultural thing that is not looked well upon in our Sharia, as we see from the actions of the Messenger of Allah, he was the complete he was the complete opposite. And as for the final hadith in this chapter, وعن معاذة رضي الله عنها قالت سألت عائشة رضي الله عنها فقلت ما بال الحائض تقضي الصوم ولا تقضي الصلاة فقالت أحرورية أنت قلت لست بحرورية ولكني أسأل قالت كان يصيبنا ذلك فنؤمر بقضاء الصوم ولا نؤمر بقضاء الصلاة. This hadith is very important in that معاذة بنت عبد الله العدوية she said to Aisha, why does the woman who is in the state of al-hayd cover up the fast or make up the fast, but she doesn't make up the prayer? And so as we know, from the things that are haram on the woman when she's in the state of her period is to pray and to fast. But when she comes back to the state of, when she finishes the state of al-hayd and she washes herself and she commits the ghusl, she doesn't have to repeat the prayers that she missed. She doesn't have to cover up the salah that she missed. But she has to cover up the fasts and make up the fasts that she missed. So if during Ramadan you miss 7 days of fasting due to al-hayd, you have to make up those 7 days. But you don't have to make up any of the salahs that you missed. And so this companion is asking Aisha, why is that? And so here she's using her intellect, trying to say, what is the purpose behind? What is the benefit behind me not making up the prayer, but making up the fast. And so Aisha radiallahu anha, she said, أَحَرُورِيَّةٌ أَنْتِ. Are you a haruriyah? What is a haruriyah? A haruriyah refers to the khawarij. Al-haruriyah is an attribution to a harura, a medina in Iraq called harura. And harura, which is close to Kufa, is where the khawarij came out from. Is where the first group of the khawarij who revolted against Ali and Abi Talib radiallahu ta'ala anhum came out from. And they had this filthy belief that the woman should make up the salah and the siyam. She has to make up the salah and the siyam. The woman who enters into the state of al-hayd, when she finishes her hayd, she has to pray the salah that she missed and also cover up the fasts that she missed. And so what they did was they placed intellect into their religion. فَاخْتَارُوا عَقْلَهُمْ عَلَى النَّصِ. They chose their aql, their intellect, over the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, over the sharia that was sent down upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so Aisha radiallahu ta'ala questioned her, are you a haruriyya? Are you from those khawarij who believe that filthy belief? And so she said, no, I'm not a haruriyya. However, I am just asking the question, because it's a question, why is it that we don't make up the salah but we make up the siyam? And so the answer is simple, and we can see here this is a benefit for us in any question that a person may ask, that why is this in the sharia? Why is this there? Why is this that? Why? The answer is very, very simple. Aisha said, كُنَّا نُؤْمَرُ أَوْ كَانَ يُصِيبُنَا ذَلِكَ فَنُؤْمَرُ بِقَضَاءِ الصِّيَامِ وَلَا نُؤْمَرُ بِقَضَاءِ الصَّلَاةِ. It's a very, very simple answer to the question. We were commanded to do the fasting, we were not commanded to make up the salah. It's as simple as that. وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. That when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees a matter, decrees an affair, then there is nothing upon you except to submit to that. ما كان لهم الخيرة وربك يخلق ما يشاء ويختار ما كان لهم الخيرة لا يسأل عما يفعل وهم يسألون. So when these ayat are firmly established into your heart, that what's upon you is to submit, at least إسلام لله بالتوحيد, that you submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, عرفت, you realize that here we have been commanded to repeat or make up the fast, but not to make up the salah. فحسبنا ذلك. That is enough of the hikmah and the wisdom for us. And so when someone asks you questions like, why is homosexuality forbidden in Islam? It's as simple as, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم وقال الله. Allah said, the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said so. That's it. وعلينا أن نسلم له. And it's upon us to submit to it. That is it. And this is a beautiful, beautiful hadith which we can use as a fundamental principle in how we answer questions pertaining to our religion. سمعنا وأطعنا وفرانك ربنا وإليك المصير. We listen, we hear, and we obey. نعم. And that is the final chapter, the final hadith in this chapter. And we've come to the end of Kitab al-Tahara. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Subhanak Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.